Sickle cell disease, also called sickle cell anemia or just sickle cell, is a genetic disease where red blood cells can take the shape of a crescent or sickle, and that change allows them to more easily be destroyed, causing anemia, among other things. Sickle cell disease is caused by defective hemoglobin, which is the oxygen-carrying protein in red blood cells. Hemoglobin is actually made up of four peptide chains, each bound to a heme group. Different hemoglobins have different combinations of these chains. Hemoglobin A, or HbA, is made up of two alpha-globin and two beta-globin peptide chains. And this is the primary hemoglobin affected in sickle cell. Specifically, the beta-globin chains end up misshapen. This is because of a mutation in the beta-globin gene, or HBB gene. Sickle cell is an autosomal recessive disease, so a mutation in both copies of the beta-globin gene is needed to get the disease. If the person has just one copy of the mutation and one normal HBB gene, then they're a sickle cell carrier, also called sickle trait. Having sickle trait does not cause health problems unless the person is exposed to extreme conditions, like high altitude or dehydration, where some sickle cell disease-like symptoms can crop up. What it does do is decrease the severity of infection by Plasmodium falciparum malaria. So in parts of the world with a high malaria burden, like Africa and pockets of southern Asia, those with sickle trait actually have an evolutionary advantage. This phenomenon is called heterozygote advantage, and its unfortunate consequence is a high rate of sickle cell disease in people from these parts of the world. Almost always, the sickle cell mutation is a non-conservative missense mutation that happens in the sixth amino acid of beta-globin being a valine instead of glutamic acid. A non-conservative substitution means that the new amino acid, or valine, which is hydrophobic, has different properties than the one it replaced, glutamic acid, which was hydrophilic. A hemoglobin tetramer with two alpha-globin and two mutated beta-globin proteins is called sickle hemoglobin, or HBS. HBS carries oxygen perfectly well, but when deoxygenated, HBS changes its shape, which allows it to aggregate with other HBS proteins and form long polymers that distort the red blood cell into a crescent shape, a process called sickling. Conditions favorable for sickling include acidosis, which decreases hemoglobin's affinity for oxygen, and small, low-flow vessels where red blood cells' hemoglobin molecules have plenty of time to dump lots of oxygen molecules. Repeated sickling of red blood cells damages their cell membranes and promotes premature destruction. Since this happens within the vasculature, it's called intravascular hemolysis. This destruction of red blood cells not only leads to anemia, which is a deficiency in red blood cells or loss of the normal levels of hemoglobin, but also means a lot of hemoglobin spilling out. Free hemoglobin in the plasma is bound by a molecule called haptoglobin and gets recycled, which is why a low haptoglobin level is a sign of intravascular hemolysis. Recycling of that heme group yields unconjugated bilirubin, which at high concentration can cause scleral icterus, jaundice, and bilirubin gallstones. To counteract the anemia of sickle cell disease, the bone marrow makes increased numbers of reticulocytes, which are immature red blood cells. This ends up causing new bone formation, and the medullary cavities of the skull can expand outward, which causes enlarged cheeks and a hair-on-end appearance on skull X-ray. Extramedullary hematopoiesis, which is red blood cell production outside of the bone marrow, can also happen, most often in the liver, which can cause hepatomegaly. In sickled form, red blood cells tend to get stuck in capillaries, called vaso-occlusion. Starting in infancy, they can clog up blood flow in the bones of the hands and the feet, causing dactylitis, or swelling and pain of the digits. Later, they get stuck in other bones, causing a sickle cell pain crisis, or avascular necrosis of the bone. Red blood cells can also clog up the spleen, which can lead to an infarct of the spleen, as well as an enormous backup of blood in the spleen, called splenic sequestration, a life-threatening complication. Over time, splenic infarcts can lead to autosplenectomy, where the spleen scars down and fibrosis to basically nothing. Having an absent or non-functional spleen makes a person susceptible to encapsulated bacteria, like Streptococcus pneumoniae, Haemophilus influenzae, Neisseria meningitidis, and Salmonella species. Since encapsulated bacteria are normally opsonized and phagocytized by macrophages in the spleen. It also leaves a person with Howell Jolly bodies, which are basophilic nuclear remnants in red blood cells, which can be seen on a peripheral blood smear. Sickled red blood cells can get stuck in the cerebral vasculature, causing vessel damage resulting in strokes. Extensive sickle cell damage to the brain vessels may result in Moya-Moya disease, which is named for the puff of smoke collateral vessels that bypass blocked arteries. They can also get stuck in the blood vessels of the lungs, leading to acute chest syndrome. This is particularly dangerous because it sets up a vicious cycle of congested, deoxygenated red blood cells preventing other red blood cells from getting oxygen. And this is made worse by the lung's natural tendency for hypoxic vasoconstriction, which is blood vessel constriction in areas of the lungs that are low in oxygen. In addition, clogging in the renal papillae can cause necrosis, which can manifest as hematuria and proteinuria, blood and protein spilling out into the urine. And in men, clogging of the vasculature of the penis can cause priapism, a painful and prolonged erection. Given all of these symptoms, it's important to diagnose sickle cell as early as possible, so it's included in the newborn blood spot screen in some countries, and can also be identified with a blood smear looking for sickled cells or by identifying HBS using protein electrophoresis. The factors that cause red blood cells to sickle, which are hypoxia, dehydration, and/or acidosis, can be improved with oxygen and fluids, which are mainstays of treatment. In addition, opioids are usually used to manage pain, and antibiotics are used to treat any underlying bacterial infections, causing acute chest syndrome. Occasionally, blood transfusions are also used, but the risk of multiple transfusions include iron overload and the risk of developing new antibodies against future blood transfusions. Finally, children with sickle cell typically get prophylaxis with penicillin and an additional polysaccharide vaccine against Streptococcus pneumoniae to help prevent sepsis and meningitis with encapsulated bacteria. Another preventative medicine is hydroxyurea, which works by increasing the amount of gamma globin, which results in more fetal hemoglobin, or HbF. Fetal hemoglobin is made up of 2 alpha and 2 gamma globin chains, so it does not include the mutated beta globins. Since it cannot polymerize, it gets in the way of HBS polymers being made and prevents sickling. HBF is the primary hemoglobin at birth, which explains why sickle cell symptoms don't happen until a few months of life, when adult hemoglobin starts to predominate, which contains the mutated beta globin. More rarely, bone marrow transplants have been used in some patients, and given that sickle cell involves a single point mutation, gene therapy is another option being researched. Alright, as a quick recap, sickle cell disease is an autosomal recessive genetic disease where the beta globin subunit of hemoglobin is misshapen, which causes red blood cells to sickle when deoxygenated, and this leads to their premature destruction as well as vaso-occlusion. Furthermore, multi-organ damage is the end result from ongoing sickling and hypoxic damage to the body's important organs, resulting in a shortened lifespan.